Okay, so it's really is my great honor and privilege to welcome Laurence to the Baber Institute for, Professor Laurence Pell to the Baber Institute for the first time ever, I think. I'm going to keep this introduction really brief. I would suggest people read his Wikipedia entry. It's quite entertaining, from which I got a few interesting nuggets, including the fact that apparently your team was got the second highest score ever on the University Challenge.
We did.
Is that true? That's...
Until very recently.
That's very nice. Among his, I guess, slightly more heralded honours, which are, I think, too many to go into, but Fellow of the Royal Society, Fellow of the Academy of Medical Sciences, member of EMBO, member of Academia Europaeae, winner of the Novartis Medal and Prize by the Biochemical Society, and winner of the CRUK Translational Cancer Research Prize. And this is really the field in which I know Laurence most, if anyone has had the, privilege, but if anyone's read my PhD thesis, they'll basically see that it's littered with structures from Laurence's lab and really like detailed mechanistic information that really his lab was one of the first to be doing, especially with regards to the fact that I think at the time people were reconstituting complexes of HSP90 and co-chaperones, but without the client proteins being there. And I think your lab was one of the first to really co-crystallize these chaperones with a client. That was, I think, what kicked off quite a lot of cool work, including HSP90 inhibitors. That was part of what this prize was for. And I'm really excited that he's going to be, I think, telling us more about this story today. And so please, Laurence, take it away.
Well, thank you very much, Raoul. It's a pleasure to be here and nice to see you again. And it's incredibly nice to be actually out and about and doing a live seminar to a select band of live people and a few people online. This is the world of hybrid presentations, but at least I can see some breathing people this time, which is very pleasant. So I want to talk about two sort of areas that we've been doing. One's already published a few years ago now, of how protein kinases are regulated by the HSP90 molecular chaperone system. And then the second part of the talk, I'm going to present something that's new, and this is the first time I've presented it. And only finished doing the presentation yesterday completely, so some of the animations and whatever's may not work, but I'll do my best. So, wow, now I've got to claim ownership. There we go. So HSP90 is involved in the stabilisation, regulation, and general enabling of a whole bunch of client proteins, and I think we were the first people to use that term, that are essentially the regulatory and control mechanisms of the eukaryotic cell. There's a whole range of different things. I'm not going to go through them in detail, but how HSP90 is able to engage with this very broad clientele is due to the involvement of a whole range of co-chaperone proteins, which in part act as adapters. They enable the core HSP90 machinery to interact with the specific protein client classes, but also many of them have regulatory roles in their own right. And I might mention one of the CDC37 in particular in a lot more detail. And over the years, as Rahul said, we've worked on a lot of these things. We've worked out how the co-chaperones interact and I try to understand the mechanistic roles that they have in HSP90 regulation and indeed in the regulation of the client proteins. And at the heart of all of this is a little machine, and this is the HSP90 dimer. So this is on the right there is the crystal structure of HSP90 determined nearly 20 years ago in our lab. And it shows that HSP90 functions as a dimer. It's constitutively dimerized at the C terminus, and then it has this ATP-driven dimerization at the N-terminus, which is the key sort of mechanochemical operation of the protein. And so you're looking now on the left-hand side as though you were staring up from the bottom here, and these are two non-engaged N-terminal domains in the presence of ADP, and if ATP binds to this, these two undergo an extraordinary change in conformation. Part of that domain really unwraps and refolds. You get a strand exchange where one strand from each half wraps around the other, and you get this dimerization effect. And when it was fully closed and dimerized, it then became an ATPase and hydrolyzed the ATP. And so you have this clapping cycle, the N-termini coming together with the binding and hydrolysis of ATP. And that's absolutely key to the biology of HSP90. Though mechanistically, quite what it's doing is still a little bit mysterious to me. At the heart of that mechanism is this N-terminal ATP binding domain, and there is ATP bound to it, ADP, in fact, in this case, in a most peculiar conformation that's quite distinct from the ATP conformation you get in kinases, protein kinases, for example. And this little binding pocket turned out to be a very fruitful target for drug discovery. And at ICR and many other places, people were very quickly able to identify very potent and biologically efficacious HSP90 inhibitors that will bind in the ATP binding site and prevent the binding of ATP and prevent that opening and closing ATPase cycle from taking place. This is a particular compound called AUY922, developed by ICR in collaboration with Vernalis. It was owned by Novartis for a while, who took it through to phase two clinical trials, but then dropped it in favor of biologics and various other things. And it's still rattling around. And I should just say, to declare a conflict of interest, that I do get threepence every few years when somebody buys a tube of this, but it never did make us rich in the end. And sadly has not really gone into sort of clinical use, although it does pop up again in lots of trials still. There's still a lot of phase two clinical trials going on for these compounds. There's no shortage of different compounds of common type around. But the key to all of these compounds is what they do in a cell. So this is from a paper of Paul Workman's that we're collaborators on. And this is a melanoma cell line with an activated BRAF V600E. I'm going to talk about that a lot later on. And this is what happens when you dose these cells with this inhibitor. And what you see is that the proteins that are known to be dependent on HSP90 for their stability of function are fairly rapidly degraded. They come back again as the drug washes out. But really important cancer drivers, CRAF, mutant BRAF, CDK4, all disappear. ERBB2 almost disappears as soon as you take the cap off the drug bottle. It's incredibly sensitive to HSP90 inhibition. And then you see through that, so AKT, for example, is not an HSP90-dependent kinase, neither is ERK, but what you see secondarily to the knockout of these upstream kinases is that you get effective kinase pathway inhibition because you've knocked out upstream kinases. And so you're achieving exactly the same thing as though you'd put in an ERK inhibitor, but you're ablating the kinase upstream of this rather than just inhibiting it. So the rationale was that we would be able to hit many, many kinases at once with HSP90 inhibitors and that you'd get lots of therapeutic efficacy. And they are pretty good in lots of different cancers, but they don't work very well on their own. And almost all of them, and there's quite a few of them around in the literature, other inhibitors are available, they almost all cause transient night blindness. And it's an on-target effect. And this has been a real obstacle to the progression of these. It seems to me not the most severe side effect, given the alternative would be a terminal cancer, but it's sufficient to mean that these are not, these haven't really progressed into the clinic as actual therapeutic agents. So this is the kind of pathway, in as much as there is one, of kinase activation by HSP90. The kinase is recruited into the HSP90 system by association with this very interesting co-chaperone called CDC37, about which more later, and they will form a ternary complex. And we've shown that you can recapitulate this in vitro and you can engineer this in vivo. And then ATP binds, there's a protein called AHAR1 that we found many years ago, accelerates the rate of hydrolysis, And puts the kinase now into some sort of activated state from which eventually it gets released through the agency of PP5, and I'm going to tell you a lot about that later on, to release an active or stable or somehow functional form of the kinase. And that's the notion of the idea of this cycle. And the presumption being that mostly the kinases that HSP90 interacts with are nascent chains. So actually, the evidence for that is not super strong. And I'll show you again towards the end that we've got good reasons for thinking that it may be more about recycling existing protein than dealing with nascent chains. The drugs work there. They interrupt this part, this stage of the process. They prevent the binding of ATP because they're ATP competitive, and so they block off all of that activation. So what then happens to the kinase that's been recruited into the system? Well, I already showed you what happens. It gets degraded. It actually gets ubiquitinated and degraded in the proteasome. And that fascinated me for a very long time, fascinated Rahul as well. It's part of his PhD work, I think. And because that predicates two things, that there must be an E3 ubiquitin ligase out there that is specifically able to spot that this kinase is somehow hanging around on a blocked HSP90. And there's something about that kinase that is being recognized, the degrom, and these are very interesting things to understand. So we set about trying to do this in a sort of systematic cell biology way. So you should be really, really worried when a structural biologist starts to do cell biology, because we will get everything wrong. And I'm sure we got lots wrong here, but I'll talk you through what we did, because I'm quite proud of it. It's a pure cell biology, cellular biochemistry paper with no structure in it at all, from a very, very excellent PhD student called Jabo Lee. So we wanted to look at, see if we could set up a screen to try and identify what was responsible for this degradation following drug inhibition of HSP90. So here's the kind of thing that you see, you know, just doing it by Westerns. You've got CRAF, you put in the drug AUI922 over a period of time, and you carry on doing blots with nice controls, and you know, you see that the kinase has gone away. It's not really amenable as a format for doing high throughput screening, running lots of Westerns. Very, very difficult to do. We also, because Jabo had some training in microscopy, we thought, well, can we do this in a microscopic way? And so these are HCT116 cells, a tumor cell line with an activated RAS in there. And you've got lots of CRAF. If you have a look, this is with immunofluorescence. And when you put in the drug, you start to see that immunofluorescent signal go away. But all kinds of other things happen. The cells are not happy by the end of that, because these cells are very addicted to quite high levels of kinase signaling through CRAF and BRAF. And so when you inhibit it, the cells really aren't very happy. And again, immunofluorescence is not an easy thing to do, you know, in a high throughput way. So we thought we would play with fluorescence instead. And so we spent a little bit of time sticking fluorescent protein domains on various points on CRAF and BRAF and other proteins. And we found that if you put EYFP on the N-terminus of CRAF, you can make the protein. If you express that protein in a normal non-tumor cell line that doesn't depend on MAP kinase signaling for its survival, the cells are happy. They don't die when you express it compared to just expressing the YFP alone, nor do they apparently, well, this is a fairly relatively short time scale, but nor do they apparently take off like crazy rapidly dividing cells either. So they're largely agnostic to the presence of this additional EYFP CRAF in the cell. If you put in the HSP90 inhibitor, the endogenous CRAF in those cells disappears, as you'd hope, but also rather pleasingly, our EYFP CRAF also gets degraded. So, and the degradation is still via ubiquitination. So again, if you block for ubiquitin, do a pull down on that EYFP CRAF, you can see some ubiquitin. And if you block the proteasome with MG132, everything backs up and you see an enhanced ubiquitin signal. So that's all says it's going down the same kind of ubiquitin proteasomal route. And if you put them into cells, there's a lovely little live cell field that went on for several hours, you can see that the protein's in there and it's not gone anywhere it shouldn't have gone. It's remaining cytoplasmic. It's concentrated roughly, if you look carefully, around the sort of cell margins, which is where you'd want CRAF mostly to be, and the cells are all doing fine. So it's behaving much like ordinary CRAF. We've not altered its behavior dramatically by putting the EYFP on, but critically, if we now just sort of measure the fluorescence in a pot of these cells, as you put the inhibitor in, you get a measurable drop in fluorescence as the HSP90 is inhibited and the degradation pathway starts. So we've now got a signal that in principle we can put into high throughput and look for things that will stop that decrease in fluorescence when we add the HSP90 inhibitor. So that's what we did in the high content microscope setup that we have in Sussex. And then doing our siRNA knockdowns. And what we're looking for are those genes that stop the degradation so that we retain fluorescence, a high fluorescence signal. And we did all the controls and shown that we can get enough of a sort of gate between controls and signal to actually process this. So we ran this. We were going to run this and we looked at what do we need to knock out. And it's actually quite big and quite expensive. If you want to take out the entirety of the E3 cis, the ubiquitin mediated proteasome. And there's probably more like 800 to 900 E3 ligases now identified. So we went for a more defined set. We went for a subset of genes that encapsulates the upstreams, the E1 that activates ubiquitin, the E2 that does the transfers, and then a selected bunch of E3s that include some of the Cullen systems, the ones that use a consistent architecture with different specificity subunits, and a bunch of other things. We didn't really plunge deeply into the great morass of ring finger ligases, and perhaps one day we should go back and do that, but there's an awful lot of them. And this is what we got from our screen. This is the waterfall plot. And delightfully, there's bits that go up at the top and bits that go down at the bottom. We've never really looked at ones that go down at the bottom. The things that go up here, the things over here, are genes whose knockout stabilizes CRAF from degradation when you inhibit HSP90. So these are the things we're interested in. These are things, of course, that actually promote degradation when you knock them out. And again, we've not looked at those. So what do we get? We've got a few things that have got really quite substantial Z scores. I mean, they're really well above background, lots of significance in there. And this is the top six. And in there are some very, very interesting things. So the most important in many ways is the second one, UBE1. UBE1 is the E1. There's only two of them in the human genome. And you would hope if you were doing a screen looking at ubiquitination that, you know, this is the positive control. If knocking this out doesn't bring down the ubiquitination or degradation of something, there's something wrong with your screen. So the fact that that's number two is really very pleasing and really validates the screen. We got two E3 ubiquitin ligases within this top set, Cull5, which had already been identified in a much smaller study, I should say, in terms of the number of things looked at, but no less significant. It was his, so I've got to say that. And then HEC-D3, which nobody had ever heard of before, and really was very strong. We went back in, as you're supposed to do, with a completely different set of siRNAs, now to repeat these, and they repeat very nicely. The top three come out again and again. These are very, very stable. UBE1 control, Cull5, and the HEC-D3 keep coming out. We also put in an E3 ubiquitin ligase called CHIP, which had been around in the literature for a very long time. We'd done some structural and biochemical work on this as a collaboration with Phil Cohen. And this is the crystal structure we determined many years ago of CHIP engaged with an E2. It's this weird bipartite E2 that actually makes K64 chains, but it also works very well with UBCH5A, which generates the normal degradative, whoops, chains. And this is very interesting because this is known to associate with HSP90. It has a thing called a TPR domain. I'm going to tell you about those in a little bit more of the second part of this talk. And this recruits this E3 ligase to HSP90. So this is obviously this, you know, potential smoking gun. And several groups had invoked this E3 ligase as responsible for this kinase degradation. But the kind of experiments and controls they did tended to be overexpress this protein and then put a disruptive mutation into the U box, which is awfully like a ring finger, but doesn't have any metal in it, so that it can't talk to an E2. And then they'd show that the massive amount of degradation they got when they transfected this thing into the cell, you didn't get, when you transfected the one that can't bind an E2, therefore this is responsible. I mean, absolutely appalling logic in many of these papers, which published in some very prestigious journals. Sufficient to say, in our hands, CHIP does nothing in this assay at all. You can knock out CHIP till there's non-detectable and we see no effect, at least on, you know, our favorite kinase, in this case, CRAF. So what about the Cul5s? So the cullin E3 ligase is a quite complicated multi-protein beast. You've got the sort of core architectural segment, the cullin itself, which brings in a ring finger subunit that's actually going to do the ubiquitination. And then you have two proteins called TCB1, TCB2, also known as elongin B and elongin A. And those are a kind of, again, secondary scaffold component. And they bring in these specificity subunits called the SOX proteins, which are able to recognize the degradant on the substrate and present it so that the ring finger protein can transfer ubiquitin to this. And as I said, you know, this was very reproducible, and this had already been seen by Len Necker's lab and by Paul Workman with Rahul's work, that this was involved in ERBB2 degradation, for example. And when we look for our CRAF, again, this is very reproducible. Knocking out Cul5, you've got a substantial stabilization. Knocking out the elongins, we also got substantial stabilization, more so for elongin A, which is something in contrast to what these two papers said. They showed a mechanism that seemed to be elongin independent, but we clearly see the effect of elongin knockout as well. We can never get any synergy, very hard to do with siRNAs, but they, you know, the assumption is that they're in the same pathway there. What we never really got anywhere with were the SOXs. We did lots of knockdowns of the SOXs. None of them gave usable, meaningful signals. So either we just didn't do those experiments very well, or there is a lot of internal redundancy between them, or there's a completely other specificity subunit that we don't know about. We sort of parked this part of the thing there, because the other one, the HEC-D3, was absolutely terra incognita. There were three papers published on it at all, and they were all sort of all over the place. So we thought we'd concentrate on that, see what we could find out about it. So we bought a commercial antibody, one of those classic ones that are made to the C-terminus of things, and annoyingly, it always lit up two bands, which was quite frustrating, but actually turns out to be meaningful, so I'll show you in a minute. And we could successfully knock that down in our HEC-293 cells. And if we do knock it down, the normal CRAF degradation we see with a control was pretty much totally inhibited. So this is really in there driving the CRAF inhibition, the CRAF degradation. And that's very pleasing. We could repeat this as many times as you'd like. We ran it across a panel of kinases that we could find antibodies lying around in the Genome Damage and Stability Center at Sussex. And ERBB2, CDK4, both of which were affected by Cul5 knockdown in the work from Rahul and others, totally didn't care about HEC-D3. They were not affected by HEC-D3. But as well as the CRAF, which again reproduces reasonably well, two other kinases we picked up in this. One of them is called Mastel. I know it much better as Great Wall. This is very, very odd protein kinase that has a 60 kilodalton insert in the middle of the activation segment. Those of you who are kinase aficionados, greatly beloved of my colleague, Helfried Hockiger in Sussex. That seemed to show some stabilization when we knocked down HEC-D3 and LKB1, which is implicated in Peutz-Jeghers syndrome. Again, part of a strange little multi-protein complex, also showed some stabilization when we knocked down HEC-D3. But the CRAF was pretty reproducible all the way through. So HEC-D3, ubiquitination is a multi-stage process. You get the putting on of the ubiquitin, and for degradation, you need to build chains that are K48 or K11 or K20 something, I don't know. You typically need to build chains till they're long enough to be recognized and the whole thing gets taken off to the proteasome. So it could have been that HEC-D3 is way down the end of that. It's just maybe putting the last ubiquitin on a chain. It never really sees the CRAF. It's recognizing ubiquitin chains. It's a chain extender. So we wanted to try and find out whether HEC-D3 and CRAF really did find each other, whether there was a sort of interaction between the two. And we set off to do this proximity ligation assay, which everybody warned us would never work and has a very, very high background. But nobody had told Jabot Lee, the PhD student, doing this. So he got it to work, of course, because he hadn't been warned that it wouldn't. You're not going to be able to see this. It makes little red dots wherever the two proteins. Don't worry. I know you aren't able to see this, and I deal with it in the subsequent slides. So, you know, untreated and AUI922, you can't really see there. If I take away the nucleus, you still can't see it. If I put the black background on, you can just about see it. But fortunately, the high content microscope can see it and counts everything for you. So you don't really need to worry about that. So the control here is a lovely one. We overexpress EYFP in the same cells and then just do antibodies against those two. And you get really no background. These are two very, very highly expressed proteins in the cell. That's the inherent background of this method, at least in Jabot Lee's hands. So this really has got, you know, the notion that this just produces noise is, I think, not true in our hands. And CRAF and HSP90 antibody pair gave us a very nice signal, as you'd hope, because CRAF depends on HSP90, which went down when you treated the cells with drug. We took that to mean a lot of the CRAF was getting degraded by 18 hours. CRAF and HEC-D3 show a weak signal in untreated cells, which goes up statistically significantly when you put the drug in. So they're kind of coming into contact. But HEC-D3 and HSP90 are clearly cohorts. They clearly find each other. They've got a pretty high basal signal, which increases significantly, again, when you inhibit HSP90. So it's saying the HEC-D3, CRAF, and HSP90 are coming together in some kind of thing in the cell. And you can do a co-IP. If you pull down on the EYFP CRAF, you can bring down HEC-D3. Treat it with a drug, that level goes down. Pretty much here, you're starting to degrade the CRAF, so you're not pulling it down anymore. But the two find each other in cells. And here again is that strange little pair of bands that you get for the HEC-D3. You'll notice here only one of them. I'll come to that again later on. And you can then co-purify the two in this way. You can pull down on HEC-D3 now with an EYFP. And this will pull out some CRAF from the cells. So the two things are finding each other. So what are HEC-E3 ligases? They're not anything like as well known as ring fingers. Ring fingers come in two flavors. They have a binding site for the E2, which carries the activated ubiquitin. And they either then have an inherent binding site for the substrate protein that recognizes the degron directly, or they have a binding site for an adapter. So that would be like the Cullens. They have a binding site for an adapter, which recognizes the degron on the substrate. And then the ring finger does the job and ubiquitinates. The HEC-D3s are somewhat different. They temporally separate the process of E2 transfer, getting the activated ubiquitin off the E2, and the transfer to the protein. So that they will take an activated E2 ubiquitin, take the ubiquitin off onto a bond with the HEC-D3 ligase, and then the E2 can wander off. And then sometime later, the substrate can come in and that ubiquitin can then be transferred onto the substrate. So they have a sort of ping pong reaction rather than a single step. And there's a few of them, nothing like as numerous as the ring fingers, and almost all of them, that, you know, they have this common HECT subunit here, the catalytic part of it, and this is the crystal structure of one of these very best known ones, E6AP. And then they have a whole range of different N-terminal bits that are believed to confer the specificity. And our one down at the bottom, HEC-D3, is the simplest. It's got one little domain that's recognizable, most of it isn't, that's called a DOC domain. And the only other place you find this is as a subunit of the anaphase promoting complex, which is that enormously complicated E3 ligase that David Barford over in the LMB spends a lot of his time working on. So that's the only recognizable feature that you've got in there apart from the actual catalytic part. So we, in a very structural biologist way, we chopped it up into sort of manageable bits. We can make them in recombinant form, the HEC-D3 full length, and the two parts, the actual catalytic and the DOC domain, make very happily as separate pieces. So this is the AlphaFold model. You know, AlphaFold is the way it predicts all these structures. We don't have to do them anymore. That's not true. AlphaFold makes pretty good predictions of things that it's already seen, essentially. So this is the AlphaFold model for HEC D3, and this would be the dock domain. So it's clearly a little separable piece. It's a sort of plug-in piece that sits on the body of the E3 ligase and provides the specificity. So we wanted to find out which bit was responsible for the interaction, and we did that using our recombinant material. So we take the cells, HEC293 cells that are expressing either EYFP or the CRAF complex, CRAF fusion, make lysates from those, spike them with our proteins, and then pull down on the EYFP. And what you can see is you can happily bring down full length HEC D3 with the CRAF EYFP, but the HEC domain doesn't bring it down, but the dock domain does. So that very much says that the dock domain is both necessary and sufficient, lovely biochemical conclusion for the interaction of the HEC D3 and the CRAF, or whatever that CRAF complex has got in it when we pull it down with the EYFP, because there's certainly HSP90 and CDC37 in there as well. So it's the dock domain what's doing it. So lately, we've been trying to plow ahead at this to try and understand the nature of that interaction. And as part of that, we've started looking at HEC D3 in vitro and trying to reconstruct the ubiquitination process. So to do that, we've made HSP90 CRAF CDC37. We express this in a recombinant form. That shouldn't actually say that at the bottom because it's not been published yet, but this bit. So we can make this protein in quite large quantities. And I'm going to show you similar, you know, some structural stuff on this later. And we can now plug this into a reconstituted ubiquitination system completely in vitro. You can buy in the E1 and E2 components and the ubiquitin. And when we plug all that together and we let it run, we give it ATP, you can start to see, you know, blotting for CRAF, you can now start to see the characteristic ubiquitin ladder that the CRAF is being ubiquitinated in vitro when we put HEC D3 in. So HEC D3 can do this. But is it specific? Because certainly if I used the chip E3 ligase I showed you about before, I could put any other protein in the tube with chip and you'd find ubiquitin ladders on it, including massive amounts on chip itself. So we looked, because this is a complex of the kinase HSP90 and CDC37, we also looked at them and we see no ubiquitination on them. There's a very, very, very faint, tiny band on the CDC37 if you really massively blow it up. And you can maybe pull a little bit out in mass spec, but essentially there's nothing there. And it looks as though the HEC D3 is being absolutely specific to the ubiquitination of the kinase and not the chaperone components, which sort of matches what we were looking for. So back to that little model, we've sort of answered that one. I mean, for one system, it's HEC D3 what does it. We don't know, however, how it does it. The degron we haven't pinned down. We know it's recognized by the dock domain of the ligase. We know it lies within the kinase domain of the kinase, but we don't know what is being recognized, and that's something that's ongoing. And it's one of those questions that can only ever be answered structurally. Well, not only ever, but it's going to be the best way. So one little thing I just want to show you, go back to this double band problem that we thought we had a problem. This is the commercial antibody to HEC D3, made like many commercial antibodies, a little peptide at the C-terminus of the protein, ligated to KLH, and then you raise the antibody to it. So it's recognizing the C-terminus, and you get two bands. So Jabo went and had a look in a bunch of other human cells. He thought Cas7 was a human cell. Cas cells aren't, they're hamsters. But you get a little signal, and you can see, yeah, there's two bands are being lit up with this antibody in HEC293s, little band in the Cas7s, never see much in U2OS. But in these two, which are MAP kinase activated, and that one is also MAP kinase activated, it's just not a very good gel, you see a fair old signal for the HEC D3, but it's all this lower molecular weight now, the 65 kilodalton band, which we thought originally was a bit of a contaminant or something, because the protein should be 97. If you go digging into the expression data for this protein, you discover that there are two well-documented transcripts. One is the full length protein, 97 kilodaltons, that encodes the whole thing from the classic, the proper start codon. And there's a second transcript, which is an alternative splice of some sort that skips the first exon and then starts translation from a methionine lying around here in the middle of the dock domain. If you put the AlphaFold model back up there and ask what the 65 kilodalton protein would retain, well, it's lost the dock domain and a fair bit of the N-terminal structure as well. It's lost the N-terminal structure and a fair bit of the dock domain, and almost certainly wouldn't be functional. It wouldn't have an intact functional dock domain to recognize. And so we checked that out, and I've already shown you versions of this. If we pull down on the CRAF and we block for HEC-D3, we only ever bring down the higher molecular weight band. So you need that dock domain and that N-terminus in order to give you the interaction. So what's that about, and why is it different in those tumor cell lines? Remember, HEC-293 is not an adapted tumor. It's immortalized, but it's not a tumor. These others are. And all three of those have one thing in common. They are absolutely addicted to substantially activated MAP kinase signaling, either through RAS activation or through a BRAF activation, which still needs CRAF to signal as well. So the hypothesis that we've got, and it's a hard one to really totally pin down, is that what's happening in these cell lines that need very large amounts of CRAF to be functional is, as part of that, their adaptation to that is they're switching off this targeted E3 ligase that ordinarily would be degrading CRAF and controlling the levels. So in order to get the very high levels, you need to switch off this degradation pathway. And one way they've found of doing that is, as in many circumstances in tumors, is by altering the splicing signal so that you're making a different isoform of the protein and one that isn't functional. And if we now do the knockdown in that cell line, one of these adapted cell lines, again, we can knock down, this time the 65 kilodalton band that we show you up there, knocks down very nicely with our siRNAs. But you see absolutely no effect on the dynamics of CRAF degradation. The CRAF still gets degraded. There is still another pathway in there. Could be the Cullin-5, could be others. So there are multiple pathways, but the HEC-D3 is at least one. Okay, so now I want to talk about, I better hurry up a little bit, some new stuff. Over here is the release process. And this involves CDC37 being dephosphorylated by a protein called PP5. Let me tell you about both of these proteins. So CDC37 is a classic adapter. It's got a region that's responsible for binding the client protein, protein kinase at the N-terminus, and a region responsible for binding HSP90 at the C-terminus. And it also has a regulatory function. If you add this to HSP90 and measure HSP90's ability to burn ATP, you find that CDC37 is an inhibitor. CDC37 stops HSP90 burning ATP. And we imagine this is to stop that ATP-driven opening and closing process while client protein is being loaded. And many years ago, we got the sort of mechanistic basis for that from a crystal structure showing how this central domain of CDC37, C-terminal region, binds to the pocket of the N-terminus of HSP90, where the ATP goes in, and it stops that transition on ATP binding. So we know how that part works. The other thing that CDC37 has is this phosphorylation. I showed you that in the figure by casein kinase 2. And again, if this has been knocked out, this site's knocked out, you reduce the ability of CDC37 to facilitate kinase activation. You get a general lowering of kinase activity in cells that have that mutation. That's not what we've done, that's other people have done. So we were quite interested to understand what this phosphorylation was doing. And fortunately, we noticed that if you overexpress CDC37 in a kinase, in this case CDK4, in insect cells, you pick up the insect cell HSP90, but you kind of swamp it. And you can get two peaks out of this expression. You can get one in which you've got the three-way complex, but with the insect cell HSP90, which is 85% identical to human. And you get a peak that's of just the kinase and just the CDC37, slightly different stoichiometry, which I haven't got time to go into, where there isn't any HSP90 in there as well. So we wanted to look at both of these, and we made a phosphospecific antibody to that CDC37. And it turns out that SF9 insect cells do authentically phosphorylate that site, as they do in many proteins. So if we just express CDC37 in insect cells, we get a nice signal. We also get that signal in the three protein complex, HCK as we call it here, or just the kinase CDC37-2 protein complex. So those are both there. So again, let's ask the question of what that phosphorylation is for. So one way of doing this is to try and take it away and see what happens. So lambda phosphatase, I'm sure you're all very familiar with, is a really, really ubiquitous phosphatase. It will take phosphates off almost anything. And if you incubate the phosphorylated CDC37, shown here, with that, you lose all the phosphorylation really, really quickly. If you take the kinase CDC37 complex and expose that in a similar way, it's also very rapidly dephosphorylated. So that phosphate group is almost certainly not buried in that complex. However, if you take the three-way complex with the HSP90 in there, now you get very substantial protection of that phosphate. So in that ternary complex, that phosphate is now buried. So that's starting to tell you what its biological role may be. Now there's a phosphatase that's also associated with HSP90. And this is it, protein phosphatase 5, again, the structure from David Barford's lab originally. And this consists of two lumps. It's got a manganese-dependent serine-threonine phosphatase, a very standard phosphatase, and it's got one of those TPR domains, these things that bind to the C-terminus of HSP90. HSP90 has this little motif, MEVD, at its C-terminus, that's specifically recognized by these TPR domains. So we thought we ought to look at PP5. So now we do the same kind of experiment. This is just CDC37 expressed in insect cells. It's phosphorylated, blotting again with the antibody. It's phosphorylated and totally resistant to PP5, unlike lambda. Lambda phosphatase cleared that away. PP5 did nothing. By contrast, the three-way complex now, which was previously completely resistant to phosphatase activity, is now rapidly dephosphorylated. If you just take the CDC37 again, add in just a bit of peptide, which is supposed to activate this somehow, you don't really see anything. But if you add in HSP90, which is capable of binding to phosphatase and CDC37 at the same time, now you permit the dephosphorylation of the CDC37. The HSP90 acts as the scaffold that brings the two together. If you add in those two here, you just see a bit of mild inhibition because you're competing by adding in just the peptide or extra HSP90, you're competing with the access to the complex. So this says that PP5 can be brought into the system and specifically dephosphorylate CDC37. And you can show in yeast, for example, that the two will pull each other down, that they're there in the same complexes. So this needs structure to understand. And this is the structure of that CDK4 complex. It looks like a Barbara Hepworth bronze statue. This is the state of the art in 2006. So this is the first EM structure of an HSP90 complex. And we did this in collaboration with Helen Sable a long, long time ago. We were very proud of this negative stain, 19 angstrom, yes. You could just about fool yourself where the pieces of protein might be in this. And at that point, we sort of abandoned this because we were stuck. The technology was not taking us any further. 10 years of technology development, and a lot of it in the group of David Agard in UCSF, and they were able to take exactly the same protein system that we use and get a cryo-EM structure at 7.2 angstroms out of this. You still can't see the fine detail in here, but you can see now where bits may be. And if you take very selective subsets of this and you polish them in particular ways and ignore the other bits, focus on the bits you can see and not the others, you can now get out to resolutions where you can start to fit pre-existing models and pre-existing known structures of the proteins into there. And that's what they were able to do. And they learned a lot about our CDK4 complex. By that time, we'd sort of moved on and got bored with CDK4 and moved on to the RAFs, and particularly BRAF. You can't be associated with the Institute of Cancer Research and not at some point in your life work on BRAF V600E, or the ghost of the late, great Chris Marshall will come and haunt you. We miss him terribly, I should say. So we made BRAF complex in the same way as CDK4. And this is that protein. It's really very nicely behaved. And if you add PP5, the phosphoserine 3 CDC37 dephosphorylates in the same way. So it's clearly a substrate for the same kind of system. We could add the PP5 protein in excess and purify a really nice complex in which all four proteins are in there now. And you can stick in an electron microscope grid using the wonderful new technology of 2022 and collect all sorts of little particles here and get a three-dimensional structure. Well, we actually got three-dimensional structures. So I'm going to take you through these quickly, because one of the great joys of cryo-EM is that you can often not need to purify the sample. If you've got a heterogeneous sample, you don't need to purify it biochemically sometimes. You can purify it in the image processing of the electron microscope images by identifying the different types of particles that you have in them. And so this is what Jasmine Oberoi in the lab was able to do. And she got three different structures out of this. And these then refined to highest resolution. So the middle one is now at 3.4 angstroms. That's where you can start to build side chains directly. You don't have to have pre-solved models by crystallography. And then we got two structures at slightly lower resolution of the complex with PP5 now bound at in two different conformations. So let me walk you through these. So this is now the high resolution structure of the BRAF V600E complex. There's the C terminus of HSP90, the N terminus. These are purified out of cells in the presence of molybdate, which is used widely in this field. And it kind of traps probably an ADP molybdate complex that doesn't quite release. It's a kind of ATP mimetic that massively stabilizes these complexes and locks them in that closed complex that we originally determined in the crystal structure really nearly 20 years ago. So what's very clear, this purpley bit is CDC37. This is the N-terminus of CDC37 that engages with the kinase. This is that C-terminal globular region that we solved the crystal structure of. And what's very clear is that its position with respect to HSP90 in this complex now is quite different to its position with the unlocked HSP90, with the free N-terminus when it's not been constrained. And so there's a massive conformational twitch and change in behavior of this domain that we don't yet understand, but it moves off into this position up here and is quite wobbly. It's not very tightly held up there. It's been displaced by the closure of the N-termini. And then there's BRAF. Hold on, you say, BRAF's 800 amino acids. That's not 800 amino acids, and that's true. All we see in this complex is the C lobe of the kinase domain of BRAF. All the rest of the protein is in the material that goes in, but you don't see it. It's totally flexible. It's not structured. We don't resolve it in the cryo-EM. We just see that C-terminal lobe. And this is it goes round. You can see the N-terminus of CDC37 going past there. There's the C-terminus, and there was the kinase domain, all tied into the HSP90 in its closed conformation. So the quality of the maps now is really superb. It's approaching crystallography quality. We can see the ATPs in the two binding sites, or possibly the ADP molybdate adducts. We can't tell the difference. We can see, delightfully, the phosphoserine 13. There's the phosphoserine 13 on CDC 37. And as was also seen in the CDK4 structure from David Agard's lab, you can see that this picks up interactions within CDC 37, and also then one interaction to HSP 90. But as we showed with our phosphatase protection, it has no involvement in the interface with the kinase itself. But it remains buried in here in the complex. This is what we can see of the BRAF in orange. That's the folded globular folded globular structure of the C lobe. And then you can see threading through the center between the two HSP90s is part of the N-terminus, unfolded, unraveled, and sort of squirted through. And again, that was seen in the CDK4 structure very similarly. It's the bit in orange here, is this is the crystal structure of folded BRAF. It's the bit in orange that we can see up to about there, linearized through here, and then the rest of that N-terminal lobe is completely disordered and invisible and kind of running out over here somewhere. The actual density for that lobe is really very good. We can see side chains, we can unambiguously position the entire structure. It's actually slightly better resolution than some of the crystal structures of BRAF that have been done for drug discovery purposes. So we can actually look at side chains in this and ask questions about them. And the most interesting question is the interaction with the CDC37, because this is the recognition. Why is this a client protein at all? And I think we're getting closer to the answer. So there's a major interface formed by this tryptophan in CDC37, tryptophan 31, and then this arginine residue at 30. And these are at the root of this little coil segment. You can see some off coming down here. And they pack against a bunch of side chains from the BRAF over here. And these are particularly significant set of amino acids. This is the DFG motif. If you're into kinases, the activation segment, where all, not all, but the vast majority of the post-translation modification regulation goes on, the thing that makes the substrate binding site, the thing that sets up the catalytic apparatus, is this little segment from DFG to APE, the activation segment. And in wild-type BRAF, at this position, 600, you have a valine. And the effect of that is a little hydrophobic residue, is to put quite a lot of structure into this activation segment, even when the protein's not got ATP bound, and that becomes auto-inhibitory, is the idea. There's an inhibitory conformation. I think nobody's ever seen it, but it's imputed. And we've got that DFG packed in against here, being held in an unusual conformation by these two residues, and the bit that follows it, we can't see. It isn't resolved because what we've got is the mutant part, mutant form. We've got the V600E. And the V600E mutant is not only a potent oncogene, but it's also a very dependent HSP90 client, whereas the wild type BRAF doesn't really need HSP90. It's not really that involved. And so the rationalization for why the glutamic acid at 600, or indeed a lysine, or indeed any other hydrophilic residue at that position has the same effect. Why that's activating is that it breaks this little hydrophobic stabilization of the activation segment in an off conformation and allows it to get into an on conformation far more readily. And it looks as though the CDC37 is picking up on exactly that same property. The fact that the bit we can't see has now become very flexible because of that glutamic acid, and that allows the CDC37 to mold the DFG into this unusual conformation. And it's measuring, in a way, the plasticity of the activation segment. And so that's our theory for why it selects clients. But again, lots of work, as the referees pointed out, to prove that hypothesis. So these are the structures with the PP5 added on. So we have two. We get one in a closed state, as we call it, one in an open state. Now, just explain what we mean by those. So this is the crystal structure PP5 docked into this. This is lowish resolution. We can't see individual amino acids in this, but we can see where the domains are, and you can see how everything fits in the secondary structure elements. And this is the closed conformation where the TPR domain packs against the active site of the phosphatase and stops access to substrate. So that's the off state, auto-inhibited. We can see that there is something in the cleft of the TPR domain. We can't resolve it, but it's in the right position to be the C-terminus of the HSP90, the MEVD, which is very flexibly linked by about 30 residues to the last ordered part of the globular part of HSP90. So there's the initial fishing bait hook that brings the TPR domain to the HSP90. And then down at the bottom of this long helix over here is a little hydrophobic residue that goes into a little pocket formed by HSP90 that now locks the TPR domain in place. So that's the closed structure. What about the open structure? So the open structure, you've still got the PP5 TPR bound in exactly the same way with the same kind of hydrophobic interaction, but now the phosphatase domain has separated. It's tethered again by something around 30, 35 amino acids to the end of the TPR, but it's separated and it's sat on top of the C-terminal lobe of the kinase. So again, the resolution isn't sufficient to position, to pinpoint position side chains in the phosphatase, because this is all quite dynamic and floppy. But fortunately, Jasmine Oberoi, the person who's been working on this in a previous incarnation, had determined the crystal structure of PP5 in a complex with a peptide substrate from CDC37, as it happens. So we know where the substrate would bind to this phosphatase. And it looks, therefore, as though the phosphatase domain is somehow finding a substrate being presented by the C-terminal lobe of BRAF. So that begs the question, what could that be? Oh, so the thing I need to point out first also, eagle-eyed amongst you will have noticed that these are on opposite sides. I'm just showing you the TPR domains now from above. And in the closed state, it's on that side with the yellow HSP90 there, the blue one there. And in the open state, it's on that side. And that's because HSP90 is a dimer. And so the binding site is there twice. You can only bind to it once because it sterically occludes the other one. But the PP5 in principle has the choice on which side to go. And it looks like when it's on binds on that side, it doesn't really find anything to latch onto on that side. The CDC37C terminus hasn't got any phosphorylation sites for it to engage with. Whereas on this side, it does have phosphorylation sites to engage with. And so that stabilizes the open conformation. But we can use this symmetry then to kind of build a model of what the transition between the two would be. And this is then a little morphing movie. And so the idea being that the protein docks onto the end of HSP90 in the closed conformation, finds its little latch, makes its interaction here, and then the phosphatase is free to move. It's got an equilibrium between a closed and open state and can kind of browse around looking for things to dephosphorylate. So what is there for it to dephosphorylate? Well, it looks like it's sat on top of BRAF V600E near, this is the last visible residue in the BRAF, 721. So we did some phosphoproteomics with Jyoti Chowdhury at ICR and Theo Roumelatos. And so we took our preps coming out of insect cells, but we're assuming that a lot of the phosphorylations are nonetheless authentic. And we found out what phosphorylations were there on our prep when we purify the CDC37-HSP90-BRAF complex. And then we took those complexes and treated them with PP5 and looked at what sites were then removed. So to give us an idea of what the substrate sites would be. And these are all shown here. And then mapped them out onto the structure. So there's quite a range of them. There's a whole bunch in this highly flexible segment upstream of the kinase. There's one just by the RAS binding domain that's known to be inhibitory to RAS binding. And there's a couple within the kinase itself and in the disordered tail following the kinase C-terminal lobe. So what I didn't tell you is that the phosphatase we put into this is catalytically dead. But that's how you trap the complex with the substrate. It can't actually dephosphorylate it. So the hope was you get it engaged with the substrate and it locks. And it looks like that's what's happened. So what's it locked onto? Well, there are two sites here with the open circles, which are going to have some significance in a minute. One of which, 729, would be not that far away from where we know residue 721 is from the structure of the CRAF, which is quite well resolved. And so it's not a huge leap for that to be stretched over into here. And that what the phosphatase has done is found phospho 729, latched onto it, attempted to dephosphorylate it, but it can't complete the reaction. So the whole thing remains trapped. And that's why we've managed to get this trapped complex. Allowing for the twofold symmetry, of course, the PP5 can swap round to the other side and then it'd be able to access the N-terminal side, the disordered N-terminal stuff that's sticking out the other side of HSP90. So the idea being that HSP90 is kind of opening out the kinase and presenting all these phosphate sites for the PP5, which combine to the C-terminus and kind of scoop them up. What's particularly significant about 365 and 729 is that they are the critical sites for 1433 binding. And 1433 has an inhibitory role for BRAF and CRAF, and I believe prevents RAS binding and is a major regulator. So the expectation would be that the PP5 treatment would disable 1433 binding. So we have actually now, hot off the press, done that experiment. We've rather overloaded the input, but we'll get to that. So the idea here is we've taken that complex, we've taken with or without PP5, and we've incubated it with 1433 protein. And if you don't put in PP5, you can barely see it here in the Kumasi, a little bit more obvious in the Western. You can pull down with the BRAF some 1433. So it could be that the BRAF is detaching from the HSP90-CDC37 complex and finding 1433. It could be the 1433 is able to still interact with those two sites, even when it's part of the HSP90, which is something we would dearly love to see. But whatever, you're getting the interaction. But if you feed it now the HSP90-CDC37 BRAF that's been treated with PP5, and indeed will pull down with PP5, now we get a substantial decrease in the signal. Again, this is really hot off the press. We've got to get the things right. The input is somewhat overloaded, but it does give a potential biological role for this, that what PP5 is doing, what HSP90 CDC37 is actually doing here is linearizing the kinase. It's doing this strange denaturing of the N-terminal lobe and stretching the thing out, and then providing a platform for PP5 to dephosphorylate that kinase. I'm thinking of this as a factory reset, that you've got a kinase, you know, the kinase has been out there in the world, it's been regulated by this, phosphorylated by that, all kinds of things have happened to it. The HSP90 CDC37 system can scoop it up, bring it in, linearize it, spring clean it with PP5, take off all these phosphates and kick it back out as a sort of naive, ready to go kinase, ready to be reprogrammed to whatever the cellular state requires. So that's our current theory. We've got to get that past the editor as well, but I think it's quite pleasing and compelling. I've gone some minutes over time. I hope you probably, it's the first time I've done this talk, so you have to apologize. An enormous number of people contributed to the work we've done at Sussex and ICR over many, many years. For the work I've just presented with you, I particularly want to single out Xiaobo Li, who did lots and lots of that HEC-D3 stuff, which had been picked up subsequently by Xavi Arangui and Emily Altwin. And the structural biology on the PP5 complexes is Jasmine Oberoi. And again, she's been helped out by Emily and Xavi. We've got all the phosphoproteomics is done by Theo Rumilotus and Jyoti Chowdhury, and Velibor Savic was involved with the HEC-D3, and Pascal Schellenberger was involved with some of the cryo electron microscopy. And I also have to acknowledge my two very long-term collaborators on all of HSP90 for many, many years, Chris Padromu and Mark Rowe, who variously had their hands in various aspects of what I've talked about at various stages. And thank these people for their support over many, many years, and thank you for your attention. Slightly out of breath.
I was going to ask all my questions, but Simon's already got one, so...
Your model at the end there, you would predict, I guess, that the AUY92 inhibitor should prevent the phosphorylation of those phosphorylation sites.
So only if you need to go through the closed conformation in order. So what we do know is in the absence of any ATP, scrupulously absent ATP, you can take CDC37 kinase HSP90 and form a ternary complex. We've never been able to get its structure because it's not locked down, but you'd have got a situation there where the kinase is tethered via CDC37 to HSP90, and you could then add PP5 to that, and the PP5 will almost certainly have, if you wait long enough, will find some of those phosphates. Whether or not the closure of the HSP90 is critical to exposing some of them is an interesting question. But so if it's one of those things that if you did get a clear effect, it would be wonderful. If you don't, it's not going to be necessarily obvious why. We do know that PP5 and CDC37 are, you know, can be pulled out of complexes together, out of cells. They certainly find each other. Exactly, yeah, when and where. We should do that experiment, Simon. Thank you for that. No, we should do that. It's not a difficult experiment to do, even with the system. We can do it in vitro, actually, and ask exactly the same question. Yeah, we should do that. But I don't know what the answer will be. I can't think. I mean, again, it's one of those. Yeah, the answer will not necessarily give you the answer, if you see what I mean.
The V600 EBR structure, that's really cool. Is there anything in the, I guess, the difference between wild-type BRAF and wild-type CRAF that you reckon could justify why wild-type CRAF is a strong type?
Which is really irritating. I mean, there are subtle differences in the activation segments, but CRAF has a V600. You know, that exact same residue is V600, but you don't need to make it a glutamic acid or a lysine in order to make it a strong HSP90 substrate. It's a very strong, inherently strong HSP90 client. You know, it's one of the first that was ever found. So, no, I don't have a good answer to that. But it's going to be about the dynamics of that segment. And there are subtle differences between the two proteins, but it is something that we now have to start poking around at. I mean, just doing an activation segment swap from CRAF into BRAF and seeing if that makes it a client is certainly worthwhile. We've thought about that before, but it's laborious because you probably want to get rid of the wild types and all sorts of things to do it. And we are not, as you can tell, cell biologists by nature, but we do have to wander into the occasion. But no.
So do you think that this chaperone function is only for resetting the kinase or to fold it while it's being made?
Well, it doesn't fold it. That's the trouble. If anything, it unfolds it. You know, if you compare the structure of CDK4 or BRAF kinase bound to the HSP90 complex with the free protein, you would say that what the chaperone had done, you didn't know that HSP90 was a chaperone. You would say, oh, this is an unfoldase. This protein's job is to unfold kinase.
So what happens if you knock it out with SAI with the HSP90?
Well, you make the cells very sick.
Do you get the same effects as when you use an inhibitor?
You can do it. It's very hard to knock out, to take it down. HSP90 is about 2% of the cytoplasm. I mean, it's unbelievably abundant protein, you know, so getting rid of all HSP90 is quite a hard trick to do. You know, and with the drugs, the observation with drug treatment is that in normal cells, you can take it down to sort of 5% of normal level, and normal cells don't seem to mind because most of the chaperone is doing nothing most of the time. It's there for stress situations. In tumor cells, which are highly stressed, a lot of that HSP90 is actively engaged. And there you need, if you knock down the levels by 20, 30%, or the functionality by 20, 30%, you get an effect. But it's not a folding chaperone, at least for this client protein. Remember, it's also dealing with steroid hormone receptors where it does something with the little helix in the ligand binding domain. It enables that to flop in and out. It does something with NOD receptors. No one has the slightest clue what it does to NOD receptors. It does things to, you know, it's sort of somehow involved in all of those. And the common feature is the opening and closing. But the specificity of that, the specific effect of that, is almost certainly mediated through the co-chaperone is the thing that enables that. And it is not, and the name chaperone is unfortunate because everybody immediately thinks of chaperonins, you know, the growy L's and the such like, which very much are about nascent chains helping difficult proteins to fold. And HSP90 has very, if you put in HSP90 inhibitors, or great work from Susan Lindquist's lab many years ago in yeast, you put in temperature sensitive HSP90s and really bring down the activity at non-permissive temperatures, you just don't see an increase in unfolded protein. What you see is specific loss of specific classes of proteins become unstable. So it's very much targeted, and it's, when the CDK4 structure came out showing this N-terminus being unfolded, I mean, we all just looked at it and thought, what's going on? This makes no sense at all in thinking of this HSP90 as a folding chaperone. And we've seen it now with BRAF. We've also got a structure of CRAF as well, kinase domain, which I haven't shown in slightly lower resolution, which is doing exactly the same. So I think this is going to be a common feature of all kinase interactions with HSP90. You get this N-terminal sort of denaturation, and all you see is the C-terminal lobe. And it just, what that's for, I don't know. I mean, one thing it will do is it will knock ATP and ADP out of the kinase. So that's something. It's removing nucleotide. If there are loosely bound cofactor proteins, a cyclin maybe. So we've done some work on this. And so CDC37 HSP90 can knock cyclin D, and I can't remember which one it is, off CDK6. So you can take a CDK6 cyclin D complex, and the chaperone will remove the cyclin. But it won't do it with CDK4. In CDK4, it works the other way around. If you make a if you make a CDK4 HSP90 CDC37 complex and you add cyclin D, that takes the cyclin off. That takes the CDK4 off. So it's not about folding. And all of those kinases are active. So these are fully folded active kinases. It's quality, I think. Well, yeah, quality control, but not in a sense of misfolded. I mean, I just like the idea that after you've been around a while, a kinase has accumulated so much phosphorylation. Some of it's junk. I mean, we know from phosphoproteomics, you see thousands of phosphorylation sites, and people waste huge amounts of postdoc hours knocking them out to try and find out the biology, and half of them do nothing. But you know, you might want to get rid of them. And so that's the idea.
So an obvious corollary of that idea then is, does it matter whether the BRAF is phosphorylated or not as to whether it binds? Yeah. Because it seems odd to service the thing irrespective of whether it needs it or not.
So we did look at, the selective interaction is actually with the CDC37, and it's the CDC, the HSP90 in some ways is not relevant to that initial thing. You can form direct binary complexes, CDC37 and dependent kinases. So we did some years ago. So you can make the kinase domain of BRAF, you can make separately in bacteria. So it's not got any phosphorylations on. And we have looked at that, and we put in activating, we thought maybe it's selecting for off conformation, you know, DFG out rather than DFG in, or some, an off conformation rather than in conformation. So we made also this solubilized BRAF with activating mutations in, and CDC37 didn't seem to care whether it was in an on state or an off state. I mean, we now sort of, you know why that would probably be. What we haven't done is look at authentic phosphorylation of that, which I guess one could do. But it's hard, from what we can see of what CDC37 is recognizing, it could in principle be sensitive to the classic threonine that comes, you know, the beginning of lots of activation segments. But certainly when we mutated that to a glutamic acid as an activating mutation, it didn't have a lot of effect. But it's possible that phosphorylation, you know, significantly, what we don't see, the one phosphorylations we were expecting to see on the BRAF in the complex of CDC37 HSP90 as we pulled it out of the insect cells, was the activation segment phosphorylation, and we very, very clearly don't see that. So that could be what you're saying, what we could have, could be that we're actually selecting for a subset of BRAF where that phosphorylation is at. That's a really good idea. Thank you very much. I'm going to take that one away. No, that's a distinct possibility. It's very much missing. You know, we were slightly surprised. We thought we might see that one, but so that could be a selective binding of the subset of BRAF that didn't get activation segment phosphorylated. Yeah, no, that would be a thing to pursue. That's the purpose of live seminars. You see, you never get conversations like that on Zoom. Oh, I haven't. How do we look at the chat? There's nothing on there. We're being monitored. They've all gone off to make coffee or gin and tonic or something.
How do you understand the ATP itself in the context of the process of writing a piece of kinase?
It's a very hard one. So again, when this was first seen, and then now we're seeing it again. You sort of think, oh yeah, ATP-driven motor. Yeah, this is, you've got a force being generated. But actually, HSP90 is the weakest. HSP90 is not a motor. It's floppy as hell, and the ATP just sort of affects vaguely the equilibrium as to whether it's open or closed. The turnover rate is 1 a minute or something like that. So
is it actually replaced?
There's no power stroke available.
Clearly 1 ATP per unraveling reaction.
No, we've no idea. So what people have then started revisiting kinases, because we're all got used to looking at crystal structures of protein kinases, which are nice globular, protein kinase fully folded. So when you start looking at protein kinases, BRAF is one that everybody's using, the same soluble BRAF construct that we published years ago, that you can make in E. coli, so you can isotopically label it for NMR and things. And when you start looking at this in NMR, it's very clear that particularly the N-terminal lobe is very poorly, very weakly folded. In the absence of ATP or a drug, the N-terminal lobes of BRAF, certainly, and lots of other kinases, is barely folded. It's sort of melting, and whereas the crystal, look at crystal structures, you wouldn't think that, of course, because that's locked in the crystal lattice. The C-terminal lobes are rock solid. They're big helical bundles and they're very stable. The N-terminal lobes are very floppy. So the notion started to appear, well, actually, maybe this is just an inherent property of kinases, that they're actually falling, they're actually doing that quite a lot. And what's happening here is the HSP90, rather than driving a conformational change, is just capturing one state in an equilibrium that's actually not uncommon. Sorry, the CDC37 is catching that, pulling the things apart. We showed many years ago that CDC37 binding knocks ATP out of the kinase. We could never tell whether it was competitive or allosteric. We'd now say very strongly it's allosteric. It's open, it's pulling the thing apart. So the ATP binding site is falls out. So, there is an inherent flexibility in kinases that nobody really had thought about before, and it might be that that's all that's going on. And then the ATP cycle of HSP90 is just a timer. It just goes, well, we'll stay close for a minute and see what happens, and now we'll let go.
What happens if you try and run the reaction with just loaded ATP and no opportunity for it to exchange?
Ooh, people have done this sort of stuff. I can't remember. So the other thing is nobody has been able to reconstruct the trapping of a kinase into that authentic unfolded conformation in vitro yet. We've been trying. We've not sort of got to anything that we can characterize. And we can't eliminate the possibility there are other factors involved in facilitating this. Lurking always in the background is another molecular chaperone called HSP70. And HSP70s are quite good at unfolding segments of polypeptide. And there's a co-chaperone called HOT or STI1 in yeast that also has TPR domains and brings HSP70 into complex with HSP90. And there's genetic suggestions that can be involved in kinase activation. It's definitely involved in steroid hormone receptor activation by HSP90. and but it might be involved in kinase. It's possible that you've got HSP70 helping with that unfoldy bit. The CDC37 then is able to take that further, and then you get the complex. So, and that will all happen when we express in cells. So if we express in cells, and so long as we put in the molybdate to trap, prevent the release of the ATP, we can get these things out, but we've not been able to build them in a way that we can characterize in vitro yet. And we've spent a lot of time trying.
Okay, so for the sake of time, if there are any burning questions, let's thank Laurence once more.
Thank you. And stop.